hell. Absolute finality. Hans Memling, a 15th century artist, pictured hell in his painting entitled The Last Judgment. And where did I see this picture? In a religious book? On a church wall? No, in Newsweek. It says here, and I quote, "Thinking of the end of the world, like contemplating one's own end, is a painful process. Sinners have reason to fear a God who, having chosen to create the world, can also choose to destroy it." Hello, I'm Karen Bird. Would you believe a book that could predict four world empires and now a divided Europe thousands of years in advance? If you answer yes, you need to know this book also predicts the complete destruction of the earth as we now know it, with a cataclysmic fire. Hell is the term applied to this event. There is a great deal of misinformation about this subject, so today Charles is going in search of the truth about hell. He'll even be showing us the place in the Middle East where hell got its bad reputation. Join us as we go in search for the good news about hell.
Last time we learned that the judgment ends in a bad way for those who are lost. We read from Revelation 20, verses 9 and 10, "And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them, and the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire." Burning in a lake of fire, this whole thing seems so gruesome. But most Christians, Protestants, and Catholics alike believe in hell. And most believe that this punishment of the wicked goes on and on for a billion millennia, and then hell is just beginning. Can you see it? Mothers who are lost, burning in pain but never able to die, listening to the screams of their small children, begging, pleading for mercy that will never come. Young men writhing in agony, cursing their fathers and mothers for giving them life. And some might reason that someone like Adolf Hitler would deserve that much pain for all the grief that he caused. But what about the construction worker who lived his whole life minding his own business? He never murdered anyone. He paid his taxes, held down a steady job, provided for his family, but never quite got around to considering eternity, judgment, and God. Never actually accepted Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. Never really knew God. Would a God of love burn him for eternity? Tormented and screaming in pain just like Hitler, always burning, burning, but never able to burn up? I believe that honest people can make honest mistakes. And in my search for the truth, I have gone through this book from cover to cover multiple times. Read casually, there are a few texts that could make you come to the conclusion that there is a hell burning right now. And those who are lost go there and burn forever. Unfortunately, less than honest clergy have used these passages of Scripture to scare people into being good so they will be able to go to heaven. Some have even used these texts to encourage donations to a particular church to ensure they will not end up in hell. But wouldn't that be righteousness by fear instead of righteousness by faith? Today, we're going to take an honest look at hell and even visit the Valley of Gehenna outside Jerusalem. And I believe that when we're done, your picture of God and His love will be much clearer. I'm not going to give you my opinions or my preferences, but a plain thus saith the Lord. Today, as you listen, you'll learn the good news about hell. While we won't be able to look at every text on this subject in the time we have together, we will make available to you a study guide at the end of the program that will be an excellent tool in considering this topic further. The first thing that may surprise you is that I know exactly how many souls are in hell at this very moment. No, I don't get an early edition newspaper each day, but I do have the Scriptures. Let's look at what it says together. In Matthew chapter 13, Jesus was telling a parable, a story, to help people understand His kingdom. He told of a man who had a field planted with wheat, and one night an enemy of his came into the field and planted tares or weeds. The weeds were most likely the bearded darnel. This common Palestinian plant grows about 2 feet tall, and in its earlier stages, it's indistinguishable from wheat. Only when the plant matures and the seeds of the darnel turn black is it easy to tell the difference. These seeds are poisonous, and if eaten, produce violent nausea, diarrhea, convulsions, and sometimes death. The growing season begins, and the servants are positive about a good crop growing in the field. But as the wheat turns a golden brown and the bearded darnel turns black, they realize they have a problem. The master of the field tells his workers that he'll let them alone until the harvest, and at that time they will separate the wheat and the tares. The tares then will be burned with fire. Now listen carefully as Jesus interprets this parable for his disciples. The enemy that sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the world. Notice this. When is the harvest? The end of the world. And the reapers, they're the angels. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. It is clear that we cannot have come to the end of this world because we're still here. So the burning cannot have started yet. In our last program, we learned that the judgment has three phases. It is the third, the last phase, the penalty phase that Jesus is talking about in John chapter 12, 48, when he says, "The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day." The last day judgment is when sinners will be cast into hellfire at the end of the world, not when they die. God would not punish that person in fire until his case was tried and decided in court. This is the very reason for the first two phases of the judgment. So how many lost souls are being punished in hell today? None. There is not one single soul in hellfire today. It's true. Look what Peter says. "The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation, and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished." Yes, there is a day when punishment will happen. Indeed, there is a day when the tares, the wicked, will be burned up. But it is not going on right now, not yet. Not until the end of the world, in the final phase of judgment. So, where are sinners who have already died? Where is Genghis Khan or Adolf Hitler? They were bad people, and undoubtedly they will not be in heaven. So, didn't they already go to hell? No. Jesus is absolutely clear on this point. The hour is coming when all that are in the graves shall hear his voice and shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. Jesus said that there would be a resurrection that will be for the purpose of damnation. If you look up the word damnation in the American Heritage Dictionary, it gives you the following definition: condemnation to everlasting punishment, doom. Everlasting punishment. That's the same definition found in Matthew 25, 46. But notice the word doesn't say punishing, it says punishment. What is that everlasting punishment? The Bible clearly teaches what that punishment is. Romans chapter 6, verse 23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." James 1:15 says, "Sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death." John 3:16 says, "God gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Death is the termination of life, the extinction of something. The Bible is clear on this. The wages or punishment for sin is death, not everlasting life in hellfire. The wicked perish, says Jesus in John 3:16, in contrast to those who are saved and who receive everlasting life. Now some might honestly ask, but doesn't Jesus in his parable of the sheep and the goats say to those who are lost, "Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Doesn't everlasting fire mean it burns forever? Well, at first glance, I would say yes, but we must let the Bible explain itself. I'd like you to consider another passage with the very same Greek word, only this time it's translated eternal, eternal, forever. It's the same thing. It's found in Jude verse 7. Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Sodom and Gomorrah were such wicked cities that we still use the word sodomy in our legal system today to describe heinous immorality. The people of Sodom and Gomorrah were so corrupt that God destroyed them with fire. And not just any fire, according to Jude. They are an example suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. While in the Middle East, I took these pictures very near where Sodom and Gomorrah would have been. There is no fire burning there. I can assure you if it was, it would be a tourist site. So why do the writers of the Bible use the word forever if they don't mean forever? The answer is actually simpler than you might think. They use the word in just the same way we use it today. Sometimes when we use forever, we mean forever without end. We say things like, no one can live forever, we all have to die sometime. But sometimes we use forever to mean a certain amount of time. We say things like, Bob was forever complaining about the job, or you kept me waiting forever. In fact, did you know that the term forever is used 56 times in the Bible in connection with things that have already ended? Jonah, for example, was in the belly of a fish for 3 days and nights. And he said in Jonah 2:6 that he was imprisoned there forever. Here, forever equals 3 days. In Deuteronomy 23:3, the word forever means 10 generations. Okay, this is what we learn from an exhaustive study of the term. Forever means as long as the nature of that thing is. For example, Hannah, the mother of Samuel, gave her son to the service of the tabernacle to there abide forever, we're told in 1 Samuel 1:22. What is the nature of man? To live so long and then die. So in this case, forever was the lifetime of Samuel. What is the nature of fire? Well, the nature of fire is to burn as long as it has fuel and oxygen. Well, could God give hell enough fuel and oxygen so that it would burn forever? Well, of course He could. But will He? No. How do I know? How is it that I can be so confident? Well, again, we go to Scripture for the answer. Revelation tells us that the fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. Devoured means to consume. Once you've devoured your piece of German chocolate cake, it is consumed, it is gone. Perhaps one of the clearest descriptions of the finality of hell is found in Malachi. For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, all that do wickedly, shall be stubble. And the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts. It shall leave them neither root nor branch. And ye shall tread down the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the sole of your feet. In the day that I shall do this, saith the Lord of hosts. Notice the verse does not say the wicked will burn like asbestos, as many today believe, but rather like stubble, which will be burned up. Nothing but ashes will be left when the fire goes out. David tells us the same thing in Psalm 37. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall be no more. Indeed, you will look diligently for his place, but it shall be no more. But the wicked shall perish, and the enemies of the Lord shall be as the fat of lambs. They shall consume. Into smoke shall they consume away. I'm glad that God destroys all the wicked people that makes this life so painful and this world a terrible place. But I'm also glad He is not a hideous tyrant, some sadistic monster who allows people to burn and burn and burn forever and ever and ever. The teaching of eternal torment has done more to drive people to atheism and insanity than any other invention of the devil. It is slander upon the loving character of a tender, gracious Heavenly Father and has done untold harm to the Christian cause. Where is hell? Is it under the earth? Or is it some distant planet? The disciple Peter gives us this insight. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Hell is going to be right here. Hellfire will be just as big as this earth, because it will be this earth on fire. This fire will be so hot as to melt the earth and burn up all the works that are therein. This is important because God is going to recreate the earth. The righteous are going to live there. I was privileged to live on the island of Saipan. Did you know that when people dig in their gardens, they are still finding bombs and bullets and grenades left over from World War II? God has to destroy all that junk. All the aluminum cans and the plastic litter will be burned up. All the toxic waste dumps, all the nuclear garbage, all the buried trash heaps will be cleaned up. Old thoughts don't die easily, do they? I can hear somebody say, will the fire really go out? Well, let's look at what the prophet Isaiah says. Behold, they shall be as stubble. The fire shall burn them. They shall not deliver themselves from the power of the flame. There shall not be a coal to warm at, nor a fire to sit before it. Yes, indeed, the Bible specifically teaches that hellfire will go out and that there will not be left a coal to warm at, nor a fire to sit before it. The fire must go out for another wonderful reason. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. The Bible also teaches that in God's new kingdom, all former things will be passed away. Hell being one of those former things is included, so we have God's promise that it will be abolished. But what about the wicked? Will they enter into hell in bodily form to be destroyed both body and soul? Well, according to the teachings of Jesus in Matthew 5:30, the whole body will be cast into hell. In chapter 10 and verse 28, we are reminded by Jesus to fear Him, which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Notice that both the soul and the body are destroyed, not perpetually tormented. The fire from heaven will, in fact, blot people out of existence. If God tortured His enemies in a fiery horror chamber throughout all eternity, He would be more vicious and heartless than men have ever been in the worst war atrocities. An eternal hell or a continual torment would be a living hell for God also, who loves even the vilest sinner. Now here is one important question that I'd like to see straightened up. Will the devil be in charge of hell? You don't have to question this one at all. Here are the words of Jesus, and the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. Well, how long is this forever? Well, what is the nature of the thing? He too will burn until he burns up and out. Look at this passage in Ezekiel. I will bring forth fire from the midst of thee. It shall devour thee, and I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. Thou shalt be a terror, and never shalt thou be any more. The devil will be cast into the lake of fire, which will be on this earth, and it will burn him to ashes, and he will be no more. That is clear. Let me show you something that I think that you'll find very interesting. The word hell is in the Bible only 54 times, translated from several different Hebrew and Greek words. Of the 54 times, 41 of them come from the words that simply mean grave. One of them comes from the word which means a place of darkness, which is what a grave is. That leaves only 12 times left, and they come from a Greek word, Gehenna, which means the place of burning. The Greek word Gehenna is a transliteration of the Hebrew Gehinnom, which means the valley of Hinnom. Here are some pictures that I took of Gehenna for you to see. This valley, which lies immediately south and west of Jerusalem, was a place where dead animals, garbage, and other refuse were dumped. Fire burned constantly, as it does at some sanitation dump sites today. The Bible uses Gehenna, or the Valley of Hinnom, as a symbol of the fire that will destroy the lost at the end of time. The fire of Gehenna was not unending. Otherwise, it would still be burning southwest of Jerusalem today. Now, we have time to look at just one more truth about this most sad and destructive conclusion to the many lives God intended to live forever. What kind of a God is it that would destroy so many lives? What kind of a God would create life and then destroy it? What kind of a God would kill men and women and children? The Bible tells us that He is a God who created us in His image. He gave us the power to think and to choose and to rule the earth. And even though mankind has chosen to use that very power to run away from God, to choose their own way, God chose to pay the penalty for their disobedience. He loved us enough not to change the commandments, but to live by the rule of His law of love. This running away from God has cost humanity dearly. Now we die from cancer. We experience drive-by shootings. Now we die alone in nursing homes and suffer from abuse of every kind. And God is asking, will you join my kingdom? I loved you enough to die for you. Satan only wants to destroy you. I'm working right now to win you back to my Father's kingdom of love. Satan is working to make your life a living hell. And I want you to know that right now I am making plans to destroy everything and everyone who chooses to continue living lives that hurt others, selfish lives. But hear my heart. As I live, saith the Lord, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. I just want the wicked to turn from his way and to live. Turn ye from your evil ways, for why will you die? For the Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. For the Lord shall rise up, he shall be wroth, that he may do his work, his strange work, and bring to pass his act, his strange act. Yes, the work of God has always been to save rather than destroy. The work of destroying the wicked in hellfire is so foreign to God's nature that the Bible calls it His strange act. God's great heart will ache at the destruction of the wicked. Oh, how diligently He works to save every soul. But if one ignores His love and clings to sin, God will have no choice but to destroy the sinner with his sin, when He rids the universe of that horrible, malignant growth called disobedience in the fires of the last day. And there is another reason for God to destroy both sin and sinners in hell. He has some fantastic plans that sin is getting in the way of. What are God's post-hell plans for the earth and His people? Behold, I create a new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered nor come into mind. Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people. And God Himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. After hellfire goes out, God will create a new earth and restore it to His people, with all the beauties and the glories of Eden before sin entered. The horrors of sin and the past will be forgotten. Pain, death, tragedy, woe, tears, sickness, disappointment, sorrow, and all sin will be banished forever. And this forever is the one that counts. And God promises in Nahum 1:9, He will make an utter end. Affliction shall not arise up the second time. There's so much more we could talk about if time would permit, but I hope that you'll request our free study guide and take time to look deeper into this subject as you learn for yourself of the good news about hell. But for now, let me just say that the good news about hell is the devil will not be in charge. In fact, he will also be destroyed along with all the evil angels that joined him in rebellion against God. The good news about hell is it will purify planet Earth with a cleansing fire that will consume all traces of sin and evil. And the good news about hell is it doesn't last forever.
There is an end to hell. That's encouraging. But the results of hell will be eternal. Now, it would be easy at this point to slip into the fear mode. But that is completely unnecessary. You can know for yourself when hell will happen, how long it will last, and best of all, how to avoid it altogether. Get your pen and paper ready because we are offering a free study guide that will answer most of your questions about hell. Like, how big is hell? How long will it burn? And what is God's real purpose in hellfire? And much more. Sneak preview? The size of hell is 25,000 miles in circumference. All these answers come right from the Bible. Now, here is the information you'll need.
Is the devil in charge of hell? To access this powerful resource, go to www.amazingfacts.org. Select the Free Stuff menu, and then navigate to Bible Studies, and then Study Guides. From there, you can read, listen, and even watch this particular study guide, as well as any other guide in this series. You can even enroll in the free online Bible study course, which will answer many of your Bible questions. Again, this study guide is available to you anywhere in the world at www.amazingfacts.org.
In our next program, Charles is going in search of the truth concerning the prophetic gift. We will join him on Mount Carmel in Israel, where he is taking footage of the place where the prophets of Baal and Prophet Elijah had a life and death duel. He'll also look at the questions, are there still prophets today? And if so, how can we tell the real from the frauds? I hope you'll join us next time as we go in search of the truth concerning the spirit of prophecy.